perhaps the most critical issue from the point of view of workers and of unions has been the impact of unemployment. There's been a whole load of studies showing, a number of studies showing actually beneficial employment effects. It turns out that most of these studies were conducted by or financed by the private equity industry itself. And because of the methodological problems involved in making these comparisons, one should be very skeptical about those. The best study, in my view, is the one conducted by the World Economic Forum, which is a fairly business-oriented organization, certainly not a union-linked or sort of leftist radical organization by any means. And they conducted a large study conducted by some quite serious American academics who did find quite substantial negative employment effects on the workers. Again, to be fair, there is a counterfactual problem here. I mean, if private equity companies are taking over firms that are underperforming, you can make arguments that, this is a price that has to be paid to keep these companies afloat, right? So, again, I'm sorry if the message isn't as clear and as strident as some of you may like, but indeed it is actually quite hard to make these assessments. The findings, I'm having to speed up a little bit, the findings on wages and working conditions are more limited, actually somewhat more negative. There seems to be indeed very substantial downward pressure on wages and working conditions in portfolio companies and private equity firms. So part of the answer why these companies can add value is that they're taking value away from the employees in the company. There is quite a lot of case study evidence also in the transfer issue I mentioned here. We have some quite a lot of case studies, notably from Germany. The findings are sort of mildly negative. I mean, although private equity is a very sort of Anglo-Saxon way to manage companies, it does seem that when they take over portfolio companies in places like Germany, with a very specific industrial relations system, if you like, to put it in a short way, based on a sort of stakeholder model of capitalism, in fact, they're actually reluctant to totally destroy that system just because it's too costly. So at least where unions are reasonably strong in these companies, these models are maintained. But below that, at the micro level, there are certainly numerous examples of established collective bargaining processes being bypassed. Essentially, the problem often tends to be that workers approach management to have the usual sort of consultations that they're used to having with previous management. The managers say, sorry, we can't do that anymore because we're owned by the private equity company, go and talk to them. And then the workers' representatives go and talk to the private equity company, and they say, what do you want? We're just a financial investment vehicle, right? We don't manage the company. So the workers' representatives are sort of chasing from one to the other. It's actually very difficult for them to find an interlocutor for their grievances and their discussions. The evidence is gratifyingly clear on taxation. Private equity exploits the tax system for what it can get, and on various number of measures, notably by the fact that the interest they pay on debt is tax deductible. Let me put it in this way: a private equity is a very tax-efficient way of running your business, right? So, from workers' perspective, it's a very nefarious way of running a business because, of course, it's again, adding value by essentially diverting money that would otherwise go to finance, schools and hospitals or try weapons or whatever. But anyway, to finance government spending. It's essentially, going into the pockets, if you like, of private equity companies. There's a whole debate about this issue of short-termism and investment. To be honest, I couldn't find any very serious analyses of this. What I've done here is simply list the arguments for and against. The chairman's tapping his foot already, so I'll be very quick. The essential argument is, you know, if you like, on the union side, well, okay, you know, you guys don't have a long-term perspective. You're coming in here for 3, 4, 5 years. You just want to get out quick and make a fuss. But the counter-argument is that, you know, at least we're here for 4 or 5 years, right? And, you know, if you think of a company that's listed on the stock exchange, you know, where large sections of the investor base are essentially, you know, people sitting in front of their computer screen going in and out of companies on the basis of, you know, from 1 minute to the next. You know, you can argue that private equity is actually a strategic investor. So it depends a little bit, you know, what your basis of comparison is. Let me perhaps skip the rest of that stuff just to give you a flavour of the debate. It's a very hard one, I think, actually a very hard one. Let me perhaps skip that summary just to say a little word. If you can give me 2 minutes. Just to say a little word about the crisis. Now, first of all, a little bit of, if you like, more sort of theoretical reflection. Why might, I mean, the crises are bad for companies, full stop, clearly. But why might it be particularly bad for private equity-owned companies? Well, they're highly leveraged, right? So they're dependent on access. They're dependent on access to the capital markets, which, as we know, has often dried up. Whereas 2 years ago, everybody said, well, this can't happen. You know, we don't have any of our economic models where capital dries up, so capital can't dry up. We've seen that's not the case. Unlike equity-based models where, you know, if the company's having a bad phase, you just say, okay, well, we don't pay our dividend for 2 years, and then we'll start paying again when we make profits. You know, if you take on debt, then you're obliged to service that debt every 6 months, usually, or every year, or whatever. As I say, the whole model is based on entry, restructure, exit. Now, if you're doing that in a rising stock market, you know, actually, you have to be pretty stupid not to make a lot of money, right? If the stock market as a whole is going up, you know, unless you really screw the company up in a bad way, you're at least going to get, you know, your money out at the end, and probably quite a bit more. In the context of a dramatic decline in the overall stock market, of course, you've got to be very good just to break even. And I have some figures which showed in the crisis how stock markets fell by 40%. So, you know, quite hard. And this is how, at the very end, how companies' financing costs increased. They shot up from, you know, 1% above what the government pays to 6-7% at the height of the crisis. So you can see this is a bit of a nasty, you know, nasty scenario if you're a private equity company. I put up this slide again, which I had earlier, which just to remind you of the very sharp decline in private equity. What that essentially said was that private equity in the crisis sort of hoarded its money, and you saw a fairly sudden stop in the buyout activity. You're already seeing this is more recent data for a thing we're planning to do. You're already seeing an uptick now in receiverships. That's this this white column at the bottom there. Unfortunately, we don't have the figures for 2009 yet. But this is actually quite a CMBOI, it's actually quite a private equity friendly institute, is noting that the pronounced cyclicality of failures and bankruptcies by of private equity owned companies. So we can expect, you know, to be blood on the floor essentially going forward. In fact, this is more anecdotal evidence here. This is not really, I wouldn't say this is based on real research. This is just some stuff, you know, looking a little bit through media reports since the crisis broke. In fact, everybody was really very worried. Even the private, when I had conversations with some of these private equity people, even they were extremely worried, really, when the crisis hit after Lehman Brothers. I think on the basis of the sort of, you know, trends that I just showed you with the stock prices and the interest rates going up. In fact, we haven't yet seen, and I emphasize this, we haven't yet seen a really serious wave of bankruptcies going beyond that that you'd find amongst, let's say, normal companies. There was a study by Moody's at the end of 2009, which didn't find actually higher bankruptcies on the part of private equity companies. Now, there's a number of reasons for this. One is that at the top of the boom, the banks were desperate to lend to private equity, and the banks the private equity companies managed to get very good deals from the banks, including various options if they weren't able to pay to defer payment and stuff. So what does that mean? It essentially means the company doesn't go out of business, which is a nice thing. Unfortunately, the banks take a hit, which is not such a good thing, especially if you're then a taxpayer who has to come and help support the banks. So again, it's a bit the old story of privatizing profits and socializing losses. When private equity companies take over a firm, they normally have a sort of war fund, which they normally plan to invest in real capital. I think in a lot of cases, what they simply did was then use that capital to stave off the bankruptcy of the company. There is a last possibility, of one which of course is rather worrying, and that is that you ain't seen nothing yet, as the Americans say. When you take out a corporate loan, normally you don't have to start paying the principal back. For several years, you just have to pay interest on the loan, and in some cases, you can even defer the interest. So it may be that the worst is yet to come. And I have a figure from this Moody's study again, which is this figure here, and you see again, without worrying too much about the precise numbers here, but let me tell you, they're in the U.S. dollar billions. You see this rapid rise in the repayment obligations of portfolio companies owned by private equity. I think this is just in the US. Watch this space. We seem to be sort of okay for now, but going forward, I think we'll see, again, quite a lot more blood on the floor before private equity perhaps reinvents itself again now. I mean, we are seeing some clever companies jumping in when stock markets have now recovered, but when stock markets were very low down in the spring of this year, you saw a renewed wave of buying. Again, these things haven't shown up in the data yet, really. But I don't think private equity is going away soon. I think it's something we're going to have to live with in the coming years as well. So I've gone a bit too long with it. Thank you.
Thanks.